The thing that I find most useful in trying to understand the folk theorem and what it says and how it works is a thing that I call a two-player plot. I don't know if other people have other names for it, but this concept is out and often discussed. I just don't know what it's called. but here's the idea of it. It's a really simple idea.
It's like a folk plot.
It is a folk plot, right? I don't know who invented this plot. So here's what we're going to do. Remember this prisoner's dilemma game. We've got two players. There's Smoove and Curly.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're going to do is there's a bunch of joint actions that they can take. So Smoove cooperates and Curly defects, or they both defect, or they both cooperate, or one defects and defect cooperate in the other direction. So what we're going to do is for each of those joint outcomes, each of those joint action choices, I'm going to plot a dot, put a dot on a two-dimensional plot where this is the Smoove axis and this is the Curly axis. Okay?
Okay.
So cooperate, remember from the prisoner dilemma payoffs, is -1, -1. So I put a dot at -1, -1. Defect is at -6, -6. Cooperate-defect is at -9, 0. And defect-cooperate is at 0, -9. So do those 4 points make sense to you? Do you understand the idea?
They do.
It may not be so obvious why we do it this way, because as you've told us, the matrix is all you need.
Mm-hmm.
But this is really just representing the matrix in another form. But it actually is sort of losing some information, because these dots don't tell us what the relationship is in terms of if one player keeps the same action and the other player changes to a different action, the matrix captures that, but this plot doesn't anymore. It's kind of washed out.
I see.